thank you for having me here. I'm pleased to be in New Zealand. This is the third time that we've been here. My wife and I, Dari, is in the back, and we love to visit New Zealand. We love to speak to our friends that are here, and we're delighted to talk to you about chronic fatigue syndrome. Thanks to ANSMEs for supporting this trip as we travel around the country. Heather Wilson, who set up the schedule for us, and Roz Vallings, as you know already. Let me tell you a little bit about chronic fatigue syndrome and help you to manage chronic fatigue syndrome. First, a disclaimer. I've given a lot of talks on chronic fatigue syndrome. I have to be honest, I can't please everybody. There's about 25% of our patients who are totally bedridden, and they're probably not in this group today. And I really, that's a whole separate ball of wax treating that kind of individual. And there's 10% of our patients who are up and around and working and going to school and doing very well. A lot of what I have to say doesn't pertain to them. What I'm talking about is that 60-65% that's in the middle, and that's probably the group that's here today. So that's what I'm aiming at. I'm going to talk about the general management of ME, CFS, myalgic encephalomyelitis, chronic fatigue syndrome. I'm going to give you a couple of new theories that we've been talking about, I think are really exciting. And if we get time, I hope we do, I'm going to give you my top 10 list, the things that I found most helpful for folks. So let me start by saying that since the 1980s, we have known that there's no marker for chronic fatigue syndrome. We've never been able to find a blood test, an x-ray, a urinalysis, any particular marker that can tell if you have chronic fatigue syndrome or not, a very frustrating thing. But we've had to rely on the symptoms. And I've always said the key symptoms, or the core symptoms, the cardinal symptoms, are pain. Usually that achy, you know what I'm talking about, that achy all over flu-like pain that patients get. But it can be severe fibromyalgia type of pain, or it can be headache pain, particularly in the men. It can be cognitive difficulties, trouble thinking, concentrating, memory, concentration, calculation difficulty, doing mental math, and fatigue. That's something that we'll talk about a little bit, because fatigue doesn't say it all, does it? It's really much more than just playing too much tennis or raking too many leaves. It's a kind of total lack of energy that it's hard to put one leg in front of the other. It may be so tired that you can't even get off the couch or get off the bed, out of the bed. And then sleep disruption, but typically the typical sleep disruption that we're talking about is non-restorative sleep. So since the 1980s, these have been the core symptoms that we've seen. And you know, New Zealand and the United States have something in common. We both started studying chronic fatigue syndrome in 1983. It was Peter Snow in Otago, was studying the Tapanui flu in 1983. And it was in 1983 when we had an outbreak in Raleigh, North Carolina, where I started practicing in the Carolinas and then moved on to Charlotte, North Carolina. So we have a parallel course here. In 1988, we wrote a paper that described chronic fatigue syndrome, it wasn't terribly well received. And so in 1994, we rewrote that paper and described a clinical case definition, a way that doctors could define chronic fatigue syndrome. So a way that doctors could tell if you had chronic fatigue syndrome or not. And that became the research criteria that for the most part has been used for the last 20 or 30 years to diagnose patients with chronic fatigue syndrome. In 2003, the Canadians came up with their own criteria that they've been using. But in 2015, pressure was put on the United States government, the Department of Health and Human Services, to do a little bit more, to look into chronic fatigue syndrome a little bit more. And so our Department of Health and Human Services contracted with the National Academy of Sciences in the States. And there's a group at the National Academy called the Institute of Medicine. So they were contracted to do three things. The first thing is they were to look at the name, because many of our people in the United States, the patients in the United States, felt that chronic fatigue syndrome trivialized the illness. It made it sound like you were just lazy. And so they wanted to get rid of the F word in the chronic fatigue syndrome, if you know what I mean. The second thing was they wanted to know, was there a better way to diagnose it than the 1994 criteria that we wrote? And so they asked the Institute of Medicine, could they come up with a better way of diagnosing, a better criteria to do it? And the third thing was, could they make some suggestions for promoting or promulgating information about chronic fatigue syndrome to both patients and to providers? So, you know, teaching people more about chronic fatigue syndrome. So they had those three jobs. And so the first thing that they did was they talked about those core criteria that we talked about. They reviewed 9,000 English literature articles that had been written about chronic fatigue syndrome to date. 9,000 articles were reviewed and then studied and looked at from a scientific evidence-based point of view. And what they concluded was that pain probably shouldn't be at the top of the list. Only about 70, maybe 80% at most of people with chronic fatigue syndrome have significant pain. And many men, for example, don't have classical fibromyalgia pain. They have less pain, but they may have more headache, for example. And so they suggested that pain be downplayed a little bit. They agreed with the cognitive difficulties, and they agreed with the patients that the word fatigue probably ought to be taken out of there, because what the patients really feel is exertion intolerance. When you exert yourself, it makes you feel sick, so you're intolerant of any exertion, no matter how minor it might be. Washing some dishes, taking a bath, putting your clothes on, drying off, getting the kids off to school, any sort of exertion makes our patients ill. And then the next thing was, if our patients tried to push anyway, it would make them sick for a day or two or 3 days afterwards, what we call post-exertion malaise. And it became clear that this post-exertion malaise was really what chronic fatigue syndrome was all about. There are not many illnesses that you get sick for 2 or 3 or 4 days afterwards if you try to push yourself to do something. So that really got elevated to the top of the pile, if you will, or the top drawer. They agreed with the sleep disruption, particularly the non-restorative sleep. Doesn't matter whether you sleep 4 hours or 14, you just never wake up feeling refreshed. And then they said one more thing. There's something that y'all missed. That's a Southern term, y'all. North Carolina term, y'all. You missed the orthostatic intolerance. And by that, they meant that people with chronic fatigue syndrome, 60 to 70% of individuals with chronic fatigue syndrome are uncomfortable in an upright position, either sitting for a period of time or particularly standing for a period of time. 60 to 70%. And this is due to not only a sympathetic nervous system problem, but also to orthostatic hypotension, low blood pressure when you stand up. So there are two reasons for that, we believe. So we'll talk a little bit about orthostatic symptoms. Well, to bring this story to a close, in 2015, the Institute of Medicine published a 400-page book on their conclusions. And as far as the name is concerned, they suggested that the name be changed to systemic exertion intolerance disease. No more chronic fatigue syndrome. Systemic exertion intolerance disease. Why? Because systemic points out that it involves virtually every organ in the body. The whole body is involved in this illness. The exertion intolerance, because it's not just fatigue, but any kind of exertion is not tolerated very well by our patients. And they wanted to use the word disease because when you say chronic fatigue syndrome, syndrome implies something like it's not real, it's just in your head kind of thing, you know? But when you say it's a disease, that implies it's a real thing. A disease has a pathology. A disease has a real reason for its being. And so they suggested using this term and calling it SEID. That's the acronym, S-E-I-D, pronounced SEID. So this is what's being recommended by our U.S. government. And I've been going around New Zealand suggesting that your physicians consider using it also. Unfortunately, in the United States, it really hasn't been embraced too well. It's hard to remember. It took me 2 weeks to remember, and I was on the committee that came up with this with this monster. It took me 2 weeks to learn it, and I still have to think about it from time to time, and it hasn't been embraced real well. So we started off with CFS, or CFIDS. You've probably heard the term CFIDS before. That was what we used. And then most of us liked your term, ME, much better, so we started doing CFS/ME, and now we have to do CFS/ME/SEID. So it keeps getting longer and longer, and I hope we'll stop at this point and not add any more acronyms onto the thing because it's getting too long on the page. So the next step was they were going to come up, suggest a new diagnostic criteria, and that's what I have shown here. It makes it much, much simpler for a practitioner to make a quick diagnosis, and this is not the absolute this is not the absolute end-all. This is not the written in stone kind of diagnostic criteria, but it's a quick way for practitioners to come up with a diagnosis and easy to think about. What it requires is that a patient have exertion intolerance. In other words, that when they exert themselves, it has a significant impact on their lifestyle and their work and their ability to do things, that they are intolerant of any activity. And that activity causes them to have post-exertional malaise, that it may put them in bed for 2 or 3 or 4 days afterwards. And then the third thing that's required is that the sleep is not refreshing. So three things are required: significant reduction in the ability to do things, post-exertional malaise, and non-restorative sleep. And if a patient has those three things, then the doctor should add, does the patient have significant cognitive dysfunction, trouble thinking, concentrating, memory, calculation, those sort of things, or orthostatic intolerance? So it's not both. You can have both, but it's got to be one or the other. So you got to have four parts. And if you have those four parts, it's likely that you have chronic fatigue syndrome. So it makes it pretty easy for a doctor to make the diagnosis. Now, that's not the end all, because we suggest that if you fit this little criteria here, then you go and you use the 1994 international case definition, or you use the 2003 clinical Canadian definition to confirm what you're doing. And of course, do laboratory studies to rule out other plausible conditions. But this makes it very easy, I think, for doctors to make the diagnosis. And I'm hoping that because it's an easier way to make the diagnosis, that a lot more people will be considered. There are many of you, I'm sure, that went for years without getting a diagnosis because people just didn't know how to diagnose. They didn't know what the symptoms were. And I think this will make it a lot easier. So time will tell. Let me digress for a moment and talk about orthostatic intolerance because it's a favorite subject of mine and it's new, something that we haven't talked a lot about. Technically, orthostatic intolerance is a clinical condition in which the symptoms worsen upon assuming and maintaining an upright posture. So that's either sitting for a long period of time or standing. And they get better by lying down or assuming recumbency, lying flat, okay? So clinically, the patient tells me, I'm not comfortable standing in place. If I try to wash a couple of dishes, I get achy and uncomfortable and I want to sit down. Or if I try to prep vegetables in the kitchen, I have to do it sitting at the kitchen table. I can't stand at the kitchen counter and do it. I've got to sit down to do that. When I go shopping, I've got to lean across the buggy when I am doing the shopping because I need that extra support. Or sometimes if I have to stand in the checkout queue, I'm uncomfortable doing that. I'll do the shopping, but then I'll go and sit in the car, and my husband will have to stand in the queue for me. So that's the kind of upright tolerance we see. In the office, what I do is I check the patient's blood pressure lying down and then standing up. And then after they've stood up for the blood pressure test, I have them lean against the wall and see how long they can stand or lean against the wall. And within a couple of 3 minutes, most patients start saying, Doc, I'm feeling a little bit uncomfortable. I get achy in the legs, or, I'm feeling a little bit weak or dizzy, or, I'm feeling a little bit headachy. These are the symptoms here. A little belly pain starts coming on after a while. Some of our patients get nervous, a little short of breath. After a while, there may be some lightheadedness, or they'll start complaining of headache. By this time, most patients are saying, Doc, do you mind if I sit down? I'm feeling a little fainty maybe. And I'm asking them, can you please stand up a little bit longer? Let's see what happens. And if they're able to stand up a little bit longer, usually I start to see a little bit of a fine tremor in the hands, or they'll start complaining of palpitations of the heart. And if I really keep them up there too long, then I start to get some real coarse movements or tremulousness. And even I've had patients faint in the office. So this upright intolerance can be very significant depending on how long and how much you push it is what it boils down to. So there is a difference, there's a real spectrum of orthostatic intolerance. The mildest form is what I've just talked about here, where you just feel uncomfortable standing for a period of time. But we also see orthostatic hypotension, where the blood pressure drops after standing a short period of time, or the heart rate goes up after standing a short period of time. If the heart rate goes up more than 30 points and stays up more than 30 points within 5 to 10 minutes and is associated with these kind of symptoms, we usually call this POTS, or postural orthostatic tachycardia syndrome. If you haven't heard that already, you'll probably be hearing a lot more of it, particularly in the adolescent population. I don't see any adolescents here in the audience, but we see a lot of adolescents, and they're particularly sensitive, as we'll see in a moment, to orthostatic intolerance. About 95-96% of adolescents have severe orthostatic intolerance, and so it's a very important thing in the younger age group. So POTS is a rapid heartbeat within 5 to 10 minutes of standing up, and it's associated with a lot of these what we call autonomic symptoms here. The second, more severe form is neurally mediated hypotension. And this is a form of upright intolerance where after the patient is up for 15, 20 minutes, the blood pressure suddenly drops and the patient faints. And obviously that's a very severe form and a dangerous form because you can't be going around fainting all the time. And actually, after the faint, the patient usually has post-exertional malaise for 2 or 3 or 4 days after a faint. So it really puts them out of commission for quite a while following that. Well, let me get back to the Institute of Medicine report. Remember the symptoms that they talked about, the exertion intolerance, the post-exertional malaise, the non-restorative sleep, and then either orthostatic intolerance and cognitive impairment. They made one other point, and that is, you must not forget that patients with chronic fatigue syndrome, ME, also have a lot of overlap syndromes or comorbidities. What do they mean by that? 85% of our patients also have irritable bowel, diarrhea or constipation, cramping, bloating. Cramping and bloating are the two big things. Irritable bladder. I was talking about it with a gentleman about this earlier, an overactive bladder where you pee, pee, pee all the time, up several times at night sometimes on account of it. Interstitial cystitis is another thing that we see in 80% of our patients. Most of our patients have migraines. 85% of our patients suffer with Sicca complex or Sjogren syndrome, which is dry eyes, dry mouth, and fatigue. Very common problem. 67% of our patients have multiple chemical sensitivities, where when they get exposed to chemicals, odors, fumes, smokes, even perfumes, it can trigger runny nose, it can trigger a headache, it can even trigger asthma in some patients. So it's a very significant, and it triggers a flare as well. Gluten sensitive, I was speaking with a fellow beforehand who discovered recently that he was very sensitive to gluten, and that's a common problem with our patients. Vulvodynia in the women, where they get pain in the saddle area. The men get recurrent prostatosis. So it's not unusual to have abdominal pelvic pain. Young people are particularly prone to joint hyperextensibility, a condition we call Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, which means that they have loose joints, hyperextensible joints. And when you have hyperextensible joints, you also have stretchy blood vessels. When you have stretchy blood vessels and stand up, that means more blood from your body can go into your pelvis and into your legs, and that makes the orthostatic intolerance worse because you can't keep your blood pressure up. It makes you more likely to be fainting. So things like the POTS and the neurally-mediated hypotension, they are also overlap syndromes. There are 33 different conditions that occur much more commonly in patients with chronic fatigue syndrome, or ME, than in the normal general population. So these are all issues that doctors have to deal with when they're dealing with chronic fatigue syndrome. So I just wanted to give you a little overview of what we're talking about in the United States and what's happening with the Institute of Medicine. That was just a nutshell of what's going on, but it gives you a feeling for what we're talking about. Let me turn to treatment of chronic fatigue syndrome and what we tell patients in my office when they come to us new, and I hope it'll help you to understand your condition and maybe give you some ideas how to manage things a little bit better. So when I have a new patient, we always talk first about four characteristics of chronic fatigue syndrome, ME, and it applies to FM as well. The first one's a no-brainer. It's an exertional illness. If you exert yourself, you get tired. If you exert yourself too much, you end up sick for a day or two or more afterwards. On the other hand, if you just sit around and do nothing, if you crawl into the bed or the couch or the sofa and do nothing, you get stiff and sore and deconditioned. So it's a balancing act. And so we teach our patients, the very first thing we teach everybody is that you have to stay active, but not too active. A balancing act. If you do too much, you get sick. If you do too little, you get stiff and sore and deconditioned. So you got to learn to balance it. And that's what we're going to be talking about today, is balancing it, okay? The second is the positional thing. That has to do with that orthostatic intolerance. The more upright you are, the sicker you get, okay? The corollary to that is if you really feel bad, lying flat is going to make you feel better. Actually, some studies at Johns Hopkins that Roz and I learned about in October pointed out that a reclined position, so if you're in a recliner, that actually makes patients feel better than being absolutely flat. Because when you're flat out, when you're stretched out flat, it puts traction on nerves and actually makes you feel a little bit worse. Here's something a lot of patients don't realize. When you contract chronic fatigue syndrome, or ME, your central nervous system becomes super sensitive to everything. Sensitive to light, sensitive to sound, a keen sense of smell. So anything that you come across, is you're much more sensitive to it than other people are. The temperature has to be just right, you know? And in my office, we talk about the thermostat wars, how husbands and wives fight over the thermostat every night to get it set just right. Because if you get too warm, then you feel really weak and milk toasty. You're just worn out from getting too warm. But if you get too cold, you're going to get those terrible rigors, and you just can't get warmed up enough. I see heads nodding, so I know you know what I'm talking about. But our patients also get sensitive to foods. We'll talk about that in a little bit. And our patients also get sensitive to medications for some reason. So we have to teach our doctors to start with very low doses of medications and build them up slowly and be very cautious with starting new medications. So hypersensitivities is a big problem. The least obvious of the characteristics is the stress intolerance. And I don't mean severe stresses. I don't mean you have to get in a fight with someone or a confrontation. What I mean is the kind of stress getting ready to get here today. That's a stress that will really take the energy out of you, won't it? Huh? You'll pay the price tomorrow. Or too many appointments in a week. Normally we recommend if you have an appointment today, don't do anything tomorrow. If you do something one day, don't do something the next day, because you need that day to recover. What's another stress? Taxes. That seems to get our patients in the States doing the taxes. And you know the number one stress, because I speak to a lot of support groups, and the number one stress that they complain about, anybody want to take a guess? No one's gotten it right yet.
Relationships?
Say?
Relationships.
No, clutter. Clutter around the house. That's the number one stress that gets people upset, because you just can't get to get things straightened around. And so when I travel around, I'll frequently stop in and visit some of my patients, and there are always piles of stuff around the house, and invariably the kitchen table is a bunch of papers that have piled up there and never been moved. So that's the thing that seems to bother the patients the most. So the second thing that we talk about in the office is pacing, which is staying active but not too active and taking frequent rest periods. It's really important to take those frequent rest periods to recharge your batteries, so to speak. So these rest periods don't have to be long. We're talking about short rest periods. 10, 15 minutes usually will do it. So then because of the orthostatic intolerance, it's important to get supine or semi-recumbent, that recliner type of position. And because of the stress intolerance, if you're really going to get benefit from resting, you really have to clear your mind. So you can't be cheering for your favorite team. You can't be watching an action movie on TV or reading a book or doing anything that requires mental work. You really have to be praying or meditate or listen to soft music or just zone out and fall asleep if you want to, but clear your mind. So taking frequent rest periods during the day, usually two or three, is sufficient. The second thing, and most important, is to set limits on your activity. And we'll really go into this in a second. But typically, when our patients first come to us, they're either what we call roller coasters or they're couch potatoes. The roller coasters are the people that go, 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 and then they crash. And then they go, 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 and then they crash, right? I think that's probably the most common. But occasionally we get a couch potato that gets into the sofa or the recliner or the bed, and they don't go anywhere from there. So the goal is energy conservation. That's what we try to teach. You've got to think of all kinds of ways to conserve your energy, whether it's a handicap placard so that you don't have to walk so far from the parking lot to the store, or whether it's if you have stairs in your home, I teach people to put a box at the bottom of the stairs and a box at the top. And instead of going up and down stairs all day, put the stuff you need at the bottom of the stairs and have someone else carry it up to the top, and stuff that needs to come down goes in the top box and it comes down when someone comes down. Instead of carrying a laundry basket, you know, carrying a laundry basket takes a lot of energy, but if you tie a rope to it and pull it behind you, it doesn't take much energy at all. So little things like that. We have lots of tricks like that that we teach our patients. So it really works. Conserve your energy. So Charlotte is a banking town. We have two of America's three largest banks are based in the Charlotte area. And so we talk about energy dollars. And the concept here is that let's imagine that you get 10 energy dollars that you can spend during the course of the day. And a normal person may spend a dollar to get up in the morning and brush their teeth, another dollar to maybe take a shower, another to dress, and then breakfast and get off to work. And so you get the idea, you spend your dollars during the course of the day. You try to have a dollar or two left over when you turn in for bed at night. So you parse out your energy dollars during the course of the day. The problem with chronic fatigue syndrome is it may take five of those dollars just to shower and dress and get ready for the rest of the day or get some breakfast. You may use half of your energy just to get going in the morning. So it's a whole different way of dealing with your energy dollars. And here's another thought about energy dollars. If you overspend your energy dollars, it's just like real money. If you overspend your money today, what do you have to do? You got to pay it back tomorrow, don't you? Right? And if your bank is like my bank, when you pay back the money tomorrow, there's an interest charge on it, isn't there? Right. And that's what we see with so many of our patients before they really understand the energy conservation, is that they keep overspending and overspending and overspending, and they get so many interest charges built up that you just can't pay them back. You know, you go bankrupt. You just can't pay them back after a while. That's what we try to avoid and try and teach people not to do that sort of thing. So the most common thing is for PWCs or patients with chronic fatigue syndrome is to push and crash. So we try to avoid that kind of thing. So this little graph just puts it in graphic form. And I'm going to walk in front of the screen. Noel, I hope this doesn't throw you off any here. But on the y-axis here, we have activity. And on the x-axis, we have rest time. And what I'm trying to show here is a person who wakes up and they say, oh, I'm having a good day. I'm going to get everything. I've got some laundry that got behind, and I've got some shopping to do, and maybe I'll do an errand or two, maybe go out for lunch that day too. So they really go out and they do a lot, and they spend a lot of energy there, and then they get a little bit of rest that night. And the next day they wake up and I'm not feeling quite so good, so I do a little bit less, but I'm still pushing because I still got that stuff I want to get done that I got behind in. But then they really got to take some rest, and the third day out, not so much energy. You can hardly get much done around the house at all. And on the fourth day, they can barely get out of bed. Okay, it's all rest and can barely get out of bed. So that's the typical pattern that we see. Or another way of looking at it, the little box up there is just like an energy box. So that's an energy unit. And most people will go for a couple of days. They'll really go, 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 go. And then they'll crash. They have no energy for the next 2 days. That's the typical pattern. Not very good. So pushing hard on 2 days requires 2 days of recuperation. What works out a lot better is if you moderate. You know, don't push as hard as you can. Maybe push a little bit better if you're feeling good. Take advantage of it. But try to keep on a schedule. Try and keep a steady. So moderation allows you to feel better and do more over the same 4 days. That's the point. Now, here's another concept that we hear from patients all the time. Doctor, whenever I get symptoms, I stop. That should be all right, huh? So if I start getting these symptoms, I'm stopping. I shouldn't get in trouble if I stop in time. So this chart shows what happens here. Here's symptoms on the y-axis and time on the x-axis here. And let's say that this person is out shopping. So she's out at the mall and she's out shopping and doesn't have many symptoms. A couple hours go by and you know it's getting near lunchtime, and all of a sudden she's starting to get some symptoms here. And what happens is she sees a couple of good bargains on the bargain table, and she's just got to get those bargains. So she stays out a little bit longer, and the next thing you know, she's so sick she can hardly get back to the car and get back home. Okay? So the point is that by the time you get some symptoms here, the symptoms can really flare up quickly, is the point. And that's what we call the danger zone. Okay? So by the time you're feeling the symptoms, you're already in the danger zone. You've already reached that point where you've overdone it. The trick is, if you can stop your activity, if you can quit what you're doing before you get into the danger zone, you won't get into that bad area there. You won't crash and have that relapse. Because the more you relapse, the more difficult it is to recover from chronic fatigue syndrome, the slower is the recovery from the chronic fatigue syndrome. You want to avoid the crashes because that's what sets you back. So the worst case that we have is the patients that couch are bedbound, and all of the evidence that we have is that even the sickest patients can get up and do a little bit something. Even our bedbound patients, well, we do have some patients that are really, really sick, and they're the special case that I told you about before that really requires special care. But the vast majority of patients that we have, even if they can only do 15 or 30 seconds of activity at a time, they can do something, they can get up, and then they can build it up a little bit at a time and build it up. And I'll show you how we do that. So the evidence is that you can and must be active. There's a colleague of mine, his name is Dr. Clapp, C-L-A-P-P. It looks like my name, but it isn't. And Dr. Clapp did a study with patients who said that they could not exercise. They said that every time they exercised, they got sick, and so they refused to do it. Some were even in wheelchairs. But he asked them to get into this study where they did 3 minutes of walking on a treadmill, and then after 3 minutes of walking, then they would sit in a chair, a straight back chair for 3 minutes. 3 minutes on the treadmill, 3 minutes in the chair. 3 minutes on the treadmill, 3 minutes in the chair. They did 10 repetitions of walking on the treadmill. None of the 10 individuals that did that had a flare or a relapse after 10 repetitions. So they did 30 minutes of walking on a treadmill. Not a single one had a flare or a relapse after doing that. So the point is, if you do it in short intervals, if you don't push too much, you'll do okay. That led us to do some research 25, 30 years ago with patients. In our office, we have an exercise laboratory where we can have patients ride on a bicycle ergometer, a stationary bike, and we can measure when they get into trouble. And what we found is that our patients get into trouble. They get that flare or relapse when they pass their anaerobic threshold, the point where the heart and lungs can't get enough oxygen to the muscles. So the trick is, don't go past your anaerobic threshold, okay? Now, what we initially found was that most of our patients could only do 3 to 5 minutes of exertion before they reached their anaerobic threshold. So 25 years ago, we taught patients, like you see on my hand here, they could push for 3 to 5 minutes, but then they'd have to rest for 5 minutes to let the oxygen build back up. And then they could push for 3 to 5 minutes, then they have to rest for 5 minutes, and push for 3 to 5 minutes and rest for 5 minutes. And you could do as many repetitions as you want. So on a good day, you could do a bunch of repetitions. On a bad day, maybe 1 or 2 repetitions is all you could do. So the good point was, if you stuck with the interval activity, the first one there, then you could get some things done. The second good thing about that was, is if you stuck with that and you avoided the crashes, over time you could do better. So over time you could do like 6 and 5 and 6 and 5, and then 10 and 5 and 10 and 5, and then 20 and 5 and 20 and 5 and 30 and 5 and 60 and 5, and eventually you could go back to almost normal activity. And we've actually had 2 of our patients have gone on to be elite athletes. They've gone to the Olympics, and we had 1 Tour de France winner who was once bedridden and used interval activity to return to elite athletics and actually won the Tour de France before you know who illegally took the title away, whose name shall not be mentioned. So it does work, okay? The problem is, it's a little frustrating to do things in intervals like that, because it's hard to vacuum your house 10 minutes at a time. It's impossible to mow the lawn 10 minutes at a time. Who likes to wash the car 10 minutes at a time? It doesn't do that very well. So it works, but it's frustrating. And so we had to go back to our exercise physiologist and ask if there was a better way to do it. And they said yes, that the anaerobic threshold, that trouble point that we want to stay below, always occurs at the same heart rate. So in our office, we're lucky. We have this exercise lab. We can put people on the bicycle and we can have them ride the bicycle, and we can measure when the anaerobic threshold occurs, and we can tell them exactly what heart rate it reaches. But for many people, you can estimate it for the majority of people, you can estimate it, unless you're an elite athlete or unless you're a real slug, one or the other. But if you're a typical average person, you can estimate it by going to the world's favorite doctor, Dr. Google, and you ask Dr. Google, what's my maximum predicted heart rate? Okay, because we all have a maximum predicted heart rate. If you don't have a computer or you don't like Dr. Google, your maximum predicted heart rate is roughly 230 minus your age. So if you're 50 years old, your maximum predicted heart rate is 230 minus 50 is 180 beats a minute. That's the fastest your heart can beat, okay? And then your anaerobic threshold occurs at 60% of that. So 60% of 180 is 108 beats a minute. So if you're 50 years old, I would tell you, try and keep your heart rate under 108 beats a minute, and you'll always be under your anaerobic threshold. So you could go out and treat yourself to a Fitbit or a Garmin or an iWatch or some other way of monitoring your heart rate, or just count your heart rate and see what your heart rate is doing. And if you can keep it under 108, you're going to keep it within that anaerobic threshold. And patients find that that's an extremely effective way of doing things. Dr. Klimas, who has spoken to this group also, she does it the same way. And many others are adopting this technique of limiting activity. So I think you can find that very effective. Another way is to wear a pedometer. We give every new patient a little pedometer, comes straight from Hong Kong, high quality thing from Hong Kong. I'm rolling my eyes. It clips on your belt or your pocket, or if you don't have a belt or a pocket because you're wearing a dress, you can clip it onto your shoes and measure the number of steps that you take in a day. And we ask our patients to go home and on a typical week, calculate the average number of steps that they take in a typical week. And most will come back and they'll say about 2,500 steps is what I do when I'm just active around the house. About 2,500 steps. That's about half a mile. That's about a mile. 2,500 steps is about a mile. At any rate, that will be the average. And I can tell you, if you exceed that average by about 500 or 1,000 steps, it will trigger a flare. So how do we use that? So, suppose you want to go out shopping, or you want to go on vacation, or you want to do something. You clip on your pedometer, and you go and you do your thing. So you're out shopping, you look down, it's lunchtime, and you have 2,500 steps on your pedometer. Oop. You've used up your steps for the day. You know that you've reached your limit. So now it's time to go home or take a lunch and put your feet up or take a rest. If you're on vacation, you know it's time to go back to the hotel room or plant an umbrella in the sand or put your feet in the pool or do something. But whatever it is, you've used up your step. Another way to look at it, you know, if your average is 2,500 steps and you've gotten to 2,000 steps, you can tell your friends, I've only got 500 steps left. How are we going to spend them? What are we going to do with those 500 steps? So that, just various ways of limiting your activity. There's one more way, the easiest way yet, and that is to ask yourself two questions. The first question is, how do I feel after activity? Yeah, if you do an activity, like shopping or going out for a meal or something like that, and you come home and you feel sick, not just tired, but sick, then you've obviously overdone it. And so you should cut that activity next time in half. So if you were out shopping for 2 hours and you felt sick when you got home, you got to cut back to an hour next time and see how you do. The second question you ask is, how do I feel the next day? So if you felt okay after shopping 2 hours, but you wake up the next morning and you can't drag yourself out of bed, then you got to cut back by 50%. Again, you invoke the rule of 50%. So, you now have four objective ways to control, to prevent yourself from going past that danger zone. That's what I'm getting at. You can either do intervals, or you can monitor heart rate, or you can wear a pedometer, or you can ask yourself two questions, but you've got some objective ways to avoid overdoing it. That's what it boils down to. Let's talk about things that we can do other than pacing and limit setting. Now let's talk about treatment options here. And so far we're doing pretty well on time. This is what I call the treatment triangle. It invokes the three major symptoms that patients complain about: sleep, fatigue, and pain. Of course, there are a lot of symptoms that y'all have, but those are the three major ones that I hear about all the time. I put them in a triangle because they're interrelated. If you don't sleep, then obviously you're going to be tired, you're going to be fatigued. And if you don't sleep, pain is usually worse because everything feels crummy when you don't sleep well, you know? On the other hand, if you have a lot of pain, you can't sleep because the pain wakes you up and keeps you from sleeping, and pain wears you out, so it causes fatigue. You see how they're interrelated? Okay. So, now the point of the graph is that we don't have much treatment for fatigue. I mean, what drug can you think of that treats fatigue other than maybe caffeine or a stimulant kind of medication? And the stimulants don't really, they just make people anxious. They don't really make people less fatigued. They just make you more hyper or more alert. But we do have treatments for pain, and we do have treatments for sleep. So those are the things that we aim to work on, is the pain and the sleep. So let's talk about that. Sleep is numero uno. That's the first thing that we try to work on. So the first thing is to get some good sleep habits. And the first good sleep habit is to use the bed just for sleeping. There's a lot of people will use the bed as their home base, if you will. Sometimes when I visit patients at home, I find that they have retreated to the bed, and they'll have the computer over here, and then they'll have a game table over here, and then they'll have all their notepads and things over here, and then they'll have a refrigerator over here, and everything is all set up, so they never have to leave the bed for anything. And that's the worst thing in the world to do, because you get stiff and sore and deconditioned, and no one ever gets better by staying in the bed all the time. So don't do that. Don't retreat to the bed. That's a bad thing to do. Never try to make yourself fall asleep. That doesn't work either. It just makes you more anxious. So wait until you're tired and then crawl into the bed. For 15 years at Duke University, we did a study on sleep habits of people with chronic fatigue syndrome and fibromyalgia. One of the things that we found was severe sleep anxiety, and the biggest anxiety producer was an alarm clock. If you have a clock by your bed, patients have a tendency to look at the clock, and it's 1 o'clock, and they look, oh my God, it's 2 o'clock. Oh my God, it's 3 o'clock, I'm still not asleep. Oh, it's 4 o'clock, and it keeps going like that. So we tell them, turn the clock around or cover it with something, or just get rid of it altogether, but get the clock out of the bedroom or hide it from view. Don't be afraid of insomnia. Many of our patients never get into a deep sleep. It's one of the things that we found about sleep in patients with chronic fatigue syndrome, is you never get into that stage 3 or 4 deep sleep, and so you don't think you're asleep, but you really are asleep. So don't be afraid of insomnia. As long as you're in the bed, rest is probably almost as good as sleeping. And then the last thing that I would point out is that it's really important to keep a regular sleep schedule. One of the worst things that we deal with is that the diurnal clock, the normal sleep-wake cycle, changes in patients with chronic fatigue syndrome, and there's a tendency to stay up later and later each night. And many times we see a patient that ends up staying up all night and then sleeping all day, and that's just dysfunctional. The world doesn't live in a cycle like that. If you're trying to sleep all day, the telephone rings all day, people are knocking on the door, appointments need to be kept, stores are not open at night for the most part. Well, now they are more and more in New Zealand, but at one point they would close at 5 o'clock and you couldn't get anything done after 5 o'clock. So that's not a good idea. So try and keep a sleep schedule that's more normal if possible. Sometimes we have to take some over-the-counter sleep medications. Melatonin can be prescribed by physicians here. Many patients have told me that they get things like melatonin and diphenhydramine on the internet. I guess you can get everything from Amazon and abracadabra these days, and melatonin and diphenhydramine seem to be two of those over-the-counter medications. Occasionally, we have to get the doctor involved, and Zopiclone is a sleep medication that's available in New Zealand that's fairly safe and effective. I believe that Zolpidem is available, but you have to pay out of pocket for it, but it can be prescribed if medications are needed. But sleep is very, very important. Aim for good sleep habits. Pain is the other big problem. And we always start, we try to avoid medications if we can, and we start with non-pharmacological therapies first. So anytime you use a muscle, it makes the pain worse in that muscle, particularly repetitive movements like screw driving or stirring a pot, cleaning a window, that kind of thing. Repetitive movements really make the muscles hurt a lot. So the first thing to do is to rest so that those muscles aren't being used. Hot packs and cold packs are really important. Balneotherapy is hot baths with minerals in them. And the most common is Epsom salt baths. Have you tried those? You just draw a hot bath and then you throw some Epsom salts in there and stir it up with your hand. It's really, really good. Liniments are great. And then the physical therapies like massage or PT, chiropractic, acupuncture, and then some electronic things like the TENS units and the muscle stimulators have also been found to be effective in chronic fatigue and in fibromyalgia. So those are things that will be helpful and non-pharmacological. From a pharmacological standpoint, I put these medications on here because this is what patients tend to gravitate to first. Acetaminophen, Tylenol, paracetamol, aspirin, NSAIDs like ibuprofen, and COXIBs like Celebrex. Unfortunately, they don't really do very much because fibromyalgia and chronic fatigue syndrome are not inflammatory conditions, and these are anti-inflammatories for the most part, so they don't really help. I know that that's what people reach for because they're available over the counter, but they don't really help that much, and they do have a lot of side effects, so we encourage you not to use them so much. What we really aim for, if you need medications, is to go with one of the anti-epileptic drugs. Gabapentin is readily available, and physicians in New Zealand are fairly liberal about prescribing it because it's relatively safe and very effective, particularly for the neurogenic kind of pain that patients have, the tingling, the burning, the numbness, those kind of odd neurological type of pains that our patients with chronic fatigue syndrome get. Neurontin or gabapentin works very, very well for that. Pregabalin or Lyrica is also available here. It can be prescribed, but again, it's not covered by your health plan, so you have to pay for it out of pocket, and it's dear, but it's much more potent than the gabapentin is. Other anti-epileptic drugs work as well. Your physicians know about those, like Lamictal, Topamax, and Keppra, which is levetiracetam. But they know about that, so you might leave that up to them if you really need something like that. The other thing that we've reached for years are what we call the NSRIs. In America, duloxetine and milnacipran have been approved for the treatment of fibro pain or pain of chronic fatigue syndrome. Well, actually for fibro pain. But for years, we've used amitriptyline, which you also use in this country. It's an old-timey medication, and it's not widely used anymore because it causes weight gain and dry eyes, dry mouth, and some other side effects that people don't like. But it does work, and it could be used. The other one that's used is venlafaxine, or Effexor is the brand name, and it works very much like duloxetine does. So that's one that's readily available, and your doctors are very willing to prescribe that one as well. Occasionally, we have to use a narcotic, and in that case, we would go with something like tramadol, which is not truly a narcotic. It's narcotic-like. But it is has a very low addiction potential, and so it's more commonly used in patients with fibromyalgia because it's not going to cause an addiction problem. More recently, we've been using a anti-narcotic drug called low-dose naltrexone. This is a drug that actually is the antidote for a narcotic. So if a person came into the emergency room and they had overdosed on, say, heroin or cocaine or even hydrocodone or oxycodone, one of those narcotic drugs, they're given a dose of Narcan or naltrexone and they suddenly become awake from it. It's the antidote for it. But we found that in tiny doses, this antidote can reduce fibro pain very significantly. So this is something that can be prescribed also by practitioners that think outside the box, like Dr. Vallings. I don't want everybody calling you and wanting low-dose naltrexone, but I know she's used it, and I've spoken with many, many practitioners across the country, and there are quite a few that are using it now and have had good success with it. But again, it's not covered by the national drug program, so it has to be paid for out of pocket, but relatively inexpensive. So everybody asks me about supplements. What supplements should I be taking? And boy, it's a big, big question that comes up all the time. Now, I've been taking care of patients with chronic fatigue since 1983. So do the math. That's 17, that's 34 years. So I've seen people take a lot of supplements, everything from melatonin to coffee enemas to IV peroxide. I've seen it all, I think. And most of it hasn't worked, I've got to be honest with you. There's an occasional individual that will respond to some of these things, but most of them haven't worked. So my colleagues and I came up with two criteria that we use to recommend supplements these days. The first criteria is there's got to be a scientific basis for it to work. You know, just don't pull it out of the air or have some snake oil salesman say this thing worked for somebody, so you ought to try it too. But it's got to have a scientific basis for using it. And the second is that there have to be some studies that show that it's helped a majority of patients, not just anecdotally, a couple of people got better on it. I remember years ago, there was a story in Life magazine about one guy that took high doses of lysine and cured his chronic fatigue syndrome. Thousands of people took lysine and no one got better. He was the only guy in the world that ever got better on lysine, so it was a big farce. And I hate for that to happen to you good people and waste your money and time on stuff like that. So this first panel that comes up here, these are the ones that have met the criteria, scientifically based, and they help the majority of people. We use a multivitamin because, at least in the United States, a multivitamin has to contain B vitamins and folate. And it's really the folate that we're looking for. But most patients will take a multivitamin for me. So we say either take the multivitamin or take folate, because that helps our patients and tends to be low in patients with chronic fatigue syndrome. B12 and vitamin D3 are not absorbed well in our patients. B12, when patients take that, they tend to get a little boost of energy, particularly if it can be injected, if you're willing to take the injection. Vitamin D3 is not just a vitamin, but it's a hormone. And so in higher doses, when we can get the levels up, our patients tend to lose the morning stiffness. You know how you get up in the morning, you shuffle like Frankenstein to the toilet, to the loo? And that tends to get better if you can get high levels of vitamin D3 in the system. But it also, in high levels, reduces the risk of cancer, heart attack, and stroke. So it has a lot of benefits to it. It's a fact that patients with chronic fatigue syndrome have low magnesium and calcium levels, and so we tend to supplement those, and they tend to help with pain and energy as well. And it's also a fact that the pituitary and the hypothalamus are suppressed in chronic fatigue syndrome, and so the DHEA level tends to be low. DHEA is a hormone that produces estrogen in women and testosterone in men. There have been at least two studies, that have shown that 40 to 60% of patients feel a little bit better as far as energy and libido is concerned if they take 25 to 50 milligrams a day of DHEA. So that's another one I put on my recommended list. The next panel I put up here, there's a lot of literature that suggests that these are supplements that you might benefit from. The Japanese have done great studies showing that acetyl-carnitine or carnitine is low, particularly in patients who have a lot of cognitive difficulties. So if you have a lot of problems with thinking and concentrating and memory, you might want to take up to 1,000 milligrams a day of carnitine or acetyl-carnitine. NADH and CoQ10 are involved in the they're involved in the Krebs cycle, which we'll see in a minute, may be a clue to what's going on in chronic fatigue syndrome, so I recommend taking those. Many of our patients have recurrent herpetic lesions in the mouth, sores, mouth sores in the mouth or other areas, and those are suppressed by lysine, so that's one you might try. There have been a couple studies showing that D-ribose, which is a sugar that's involved in metabolism, has been helpful, and so you might want to consider D-ribose. And then lastly, amino acids, which you'll see in a minute why amino acids are important. But they tend to be utilized by the citric acid cycle. The last three are for those of you who go to the internet a lot. If you have heard about the methylation process, or if you've read about mitochondrial dysfunction, a lot of the people that write about that talk about supplementing with methylfolate or folinic acid, one or the other, or a phosphatidylserine. I'm not keen on those three, but there certainly is no harm from taking them, and there's a scientific basis for using them, so you might want to consider supplementing with those. But those are the big supplements that I would recommend. I can't recommend most anything else but those. So let me I'm just about finished up here now. I did want to mention some of the advanced therapies that practitioners who deal with chronic fatigue syndrome on a regular daily basis may use. For the orthostatic intolerance, the most important thing is to build up blood volume or water volume in the system, if you will. And so it's important to drink at least 2 liters of water each day. If you have orthostatic intolerance, the water goes in one end and out the other, and unless you take a solute with it. So unless you have high blood pressure, it's important to take a little salt with that water. We normally recommend 1/2 to 1 teaspoon of salt each day to keep that water in your system. So that's the treatment for orthostatic intolerance, and doctors may prescribe other medications as well, depending on what kind of orthostatic intolerance you have. I mentioned earlier the diet may be important, and many of our patients are sensitive to gluten particularly, but others to dairy. And empirically, we found that there are certain foods that patients don't tolerate very well, and that's what the acronym SCANT is all about. SCANT stands for sugar, caffeine, alcohol, NutraSweet or neurotoxins. So the other neurotoxins are like MSG is a big one, and the nightshade vegetables, believe it or not. So that would be like peppers, green and red peppers, tomatoes, and eggplant. Those are the nightshade vegetables. And then T is for tobacco. So sugar, caffeine, alcohol, NutraSweet, which is aspartame, and tobacco. For patients who have a lot of viral problems, viral symptoms, those are the ones that get the recurrent mouth ulcers. I also have patients that get shingles every month, if you can imagine that. You know how bad shingles are. I have some patients get them every month or two, and they need to be on antiviral medications. Many of our patients have low cortisol levels on account of the hypothalamic and pituitary suppression. And so we sometimes try them on low doses of hydrocortisone. I've heard from a couple of your doctors in this country, and the endocrinologists are not keen on doing this, so I think it would be hard to maybe get done in New Zealand, but occasionally it does help a little bit. From Oregon, in the United States, the Oregon Health University. There have been several papers pointing out that human growth hormone is also low in patients with chronic fatigue syndrome and fibromyalgia because the pituitary is suppressed. And treatment with growth hormone does make patients feel better. The problem is it's very expensive, and more importantly, it carries a high risk of breast cancer and prostate cancer. And so I don't really know anybody that's using it right now, even though it can be helpful. And the last thing that I would mention is that there are three experimental drugs available right now. Amplogen is a drug that we've been using. I think my battery just died. Amplogen is an immune modulating antiviral drug that we've been studying since 1988. And about 60% of patients, 60% of patients with chronic fatigue syndrome have improvement when they use Amplogen. But it's only been available in the United States to date. And it's only available as an investigational drug, very expensive, and so it's not really widely used. We're trying to get it approved for use throughout the world, but it's been a slow process. The second thing is that many patients that have flu-like symptoms, you know, the patient has the sore throat, the swollen glands, the feverishness, the chills, on a regular basis or a frequent basis, they frequently have high levels of cytokines in the system. And they may respond to cytokine inhibitors like Enbrel, Humira, and Remicade. Again, very expensive. These are drugs that are normally used to treat rheumatoid arthritis, Crohn's disease, ulcerative colitis, and psoriatic arthritis. So I love it when a patient comes into my office that has one of those conditions and chronic fatigue syndrome, because I can legally treat them with those drugs. And I get two birds with one stone there, which is really nice. I have a few patients have psoriasis and chronic fatigue syndrome, and I can treat them with Enbrel, and they do really well with that. That's nice. Now, rituximab. Do you all know about rituximab? Some of you do, some of you don't. Okay. A quick overview on rituximab. There are two oncologists in Norway, Dr. Øystein Fluge and Olav Mella, who several years ago treated two women who had both B-cell lymphoma and chronic fatigue syndrome. Because they were oncologists, they treated the lymphoma with a chemotherapy drug called Rituxan or rituximab. And surprisingly, when they used that chemotherapy drug, it not only cured the lymphoma, but the chronic fatigue syndrome disappeared as well. Now, you might not know that the city of Oslo, which is near Bergen where they practice, the city of Oslo had an outbreak of Giardia, just like you did down in Tapanui in 1983. Their outbreak was about 9 years ago. And they had 300 individuals fell ill with chronic fatigue syndrome after that outbreak of Giardia there. So they had a large population of patients with chronic fatigue syndrome. And these doctors thought it was interesting that the chronic fatigue syndrome got better. And so apparently they went to the support group and asked if there were 10 women who would volunteer to take the chemotherapy and see if their chronic fatigue syndrome would get better. And so they did that. Now, this is not the kind of chemotherapy where you lose your hair and you get sick and nauseated and all that stuff. It's a very mild form of chemotherapy. And the 10 women in the pilot study all improved by taking the rituximab. So since then, doctors Mella and Fluge have been doing much more enlarged studies, phase two and phase three studies, to find out what doses can be used and how often they should be used and whether there are other chemotherapeutic drugs that might be effective that would treat chronic fatigue syndrome. But I'll give you a little bit more of the story in just a second here. let me move on here, and you'll see how it all works together with the Norwegian story here. So this is a recent paper that was published just in September by Dr. Navio, who is at Stanford University in California, back in the States. And Dr. Navio found that there were reduced levels of sphingolipids, phospholipids, purines, riboflavin, and amino acids in patients with chronic fatigue syndrome. And this is not anything that's new. We've known this for many, many years. But what Navio pointed out was that the pattern of reductions here, the patterns of deviations here, is similar to what's seen in an individual who's in starvation or in hibernation, like a bear that's in hibernation, or, as he pointed out, as like an earthworm that's in hibernation. And he pointed out that earthworms have the ability to flip a metabolic switch, and they can go into a state of hibernation that allows them to live 8 times longer than they would normally live, because their body metabolism slows down so much that they don't require very much to survive, okay? So Navio's theory, basically, if I can simplify it, is that perhaps patients with chronic fatigue syndrome have a metabolic switch and they go into a state of like starvation or hibernation as a protective mechanism. Maybe there's something that's happened to people with chronic fatigue syndrome that they're going into this state, and this slow metabolism rate is really a protective mechanism, and can be switched off if we can only find out how to do it, okay? So very, very interesting. But the amino acid thing came up again in studies by Dr. Fluge and Mella, the fellows from Bergen, Norway, that I just mentioned earlier. Here they are here in a paper that they just published 2 months ago. So this is about as current as it gets. Now, this is something that we call the Krebs cycle or the citric acid cycle. And it looks complicated, but I'll try and make it real easy for you. When you eat carbohydrate, when you eat sugars, the sugars get broken down into pyruvic acid, and pyruvic acid is converted to acetyl-CoA by an enzyme, which is not shown here. But the enzyme is right there, and it's called pyruvate dehydrogenase, or PDH. You got that? So sugar becomes pyruvate, becomes acetyl-CoA through PDH. Okay. So what these researchers found was that acetyl-CoA was low in patients with chronic fatigue syndrome. And as Paul Cheney and I found many, many years ago, a lot of the cofactors in the Krebs cycle were low as well, which is why 30 years ago, 25 years ago, we encouraged patients to use B12 and magnesium and CoQ10 and succinate and malate and all of these things, and amino acids. We encouraged patients to take all of these things because they were low, and they all belong to this citric acid cycle. And the citric acid cycle makes ATP. Whenever you have a molecule of acetyl-CoA, it goes through the cycle and it makes several molecules of ATP, which is the energy source of the body. And we knew 25 years ago, 30 years ago, that ATP is always low in patients with chronic fatigue syndrome. So we suspected that this Krebs cycle or the citric acid cycle was at fault. And so we thought that if we fed these elements, if we fed these missing parts to patients, that they would feel better. And indeed they did, but it wasn't a cure. They felt better, but it wasn't a cure. So Fluge and Mella went a step further. They were trying to explain why these things were happening. And in particular, an unusual thing happened when they gave the rituximab. The B cells, the lymphoma, they disappeared in about 3 weeks, 3 to 6 weeks. But the chronic fatigue syndrome took 3 to 6 months to get better. So why the difference? Why did it take so much longer for the chronic fatigue syndrome to get better? They couldn't explain that. until they started looking up here at this pyruvate dehydrogenase. They felt that this was the problem why acetyl-CoA was so low in patients with chronic fatigue syndrome. And so when they looked at the pyruvate dehydrogenase, they found out that there were inhibitory antibodies. So there were chemicals that were inhibiting the enzyme from working. Does that make sense to you? Okay. Now it turns out that B cells, what they were killing off, the B cells that they were killing off are the cells that make antibodies. So their theory became that they killed off the B cells, but the antibodies were still circulating. They take 3 to 6 months before they end up eventually dying off. And that's why it took so much longer for this reaction to start speeding up again. In the meantime, they pointed out that you can make acetyl-CoA by using the amino acids in your body. You don't need to use pyruvate. That when pyruvate is not available, you can suck up amino acids from the bloodstream and use amino acids to make acetyl-CoA, which is why the amino acids were low in patients with chronic fatigue syndrome. And so that's why when we gave patients amino acids, why they sometimes felt a lot better, because we were feeding the engine, so to speak, giving the engine fuel. So this is a current theory that they're investigating. We're expecting a paper out this month and another paper in October to see how close the theory goes with the scientific studies that we're doing. It'll be interesting to see what comes out of the whole thing. So any questions on that? I know that's a hard concept. One question, yeah, a couple questions.
Should we be supplementing with amino acids?
That's one of the supplements that was on the list there. It's something you might want to consider. They come in a capsule, and they've just put a whole bunch of them in there. It's sort of a shotgun approach, but it does work. And you might want to try it. Yes, ma'am?
I was wondering, so if you don't have carbohydrates, does that solve it?
What's that now?
If you don't eat carbohydrates, does that solve it?
Oh, no, you're always going to get carbohydrates. You'll get them from somewhere. There's always carbohydrate that you eat. Even if you try to avoid them, you're always going to get some carbohydrate. Yeah. Food will get converted into that pyruvate regardless. Yes, sir, Antoine?
What she was asking was, does it help if you keep your carbohydrates down?
I don't know. That's a good question. I don't know the answer to that. Yeah. I don't think it hurts, but I don't really know the answer to that, Antoine.
I did find improvement on adding more protein rather than...
Yeah, that might be the answer.
Can I just ask, I've always maintained that the ATP, we convert well enough into ATP, but we can't convert it back into ADP. Am I close or not? Am I not completely tracked there?
The important thing is to get the ATP, because that's the source of energy. Converting back to the ADP, I don't think is an issue.
It's not an issue.
Yeah, not that I'm aware of, yeah. Well, let's move on. I just put this slide up very quickly because a lot of you will get onto the internet and you'll read about these different theoretical approaches. What I would point out that these are hypothetical treatments for chronic fatigue syndrome that have been discussed over the years. I would point out that most of these names on here are not medical doctors. Half of them are, some of them are educators, some of them are, they're not doctors. They're not medical doctors, let me put it that way. And many of these are just hypothetical ideas. I don't think anybody would be advised to follow any of these suggestions that are up here, are these theoretical approaches, because for the most part they have not been successful over the years, and I just wanted you to be aware of them, and if you have questions about them, why don't you check with me afterwards, and I'll tell you why I have that opinion on them, and we'll leave it at that. So we have time for the top 10 list.
Yes.
Okay, all right, here we go. You won't like this one. CBT or counseling? Everybody hates CBT. I don't mean CBT the way you mean CBT. What I mean is that it really helps to have a coach. It has someone who can encourage you along to keep you going, because this is a slow process to get better with chronic fatigue syndrome, and you need someone who is going to encourage you along and keep you going in a positive direction. So this is not psychological counseling in any way. This is coaching, if you will, lifestyle coaching, if you will. Volume expansion, we have so many patients that have orthostatic intolerance that the majority of patients really benefit from drinking lots and lots of fluids and taking the salt. The physical therapies are really important, stretching in particular, but keeping physically active, just walking. Pool therapy is extremely helpful for our patients. That's really, really good. Probably walking, pool therapy, and cycling on a stationary bicycle are the three that are best. Stimulant medications have been very helpful for our folks, particularly there are about 60% of our patients who are somnolent during the day, fall asleep watching TV, fall asleep reading, fall asleep in church, they fall asleep using the computer. And if you're that kind of individual, probably have a sleep disorder that needs to be followed by your primary care doctor or a sleep specialist, and a stimulant medication to keep you awake during the day could be helpful. The B12 we've talked about already, particularly by injection. Pain medication, for those that have severe problems with fibromyalgia pain. Clonazepam, this is benzodiazepine that helps people to fall asleep at night. I really didn't mention that one earlier, but it does help people to fall asleep. Years ago, when we didn't have many medications to recommend to patients, the two that we used most widely were B12 and clonazepam. Clonazepam for sleep and B12 for energy. And we used to ask patients, if you were marooned on a desert island, what medication would you like to have? And they always said clonazepam. That was the one thing that they wanted to have with them, because it would help them to fall asleep and calm things down. That is available here, yeah. Diet is a really, really big thing, particularly the gluten-free and the dairy-free. So I put that very high, and then the stretching and the low-level activity. So that means pacing and limit setting that we spent a lot of time talking at. So these are no-brainers, but I've been at it a long time, and these are the things that I found most helpful in getting our patients back on track. So thanks very much for having me. It's been a pleasure. And hope to get back and see some more glowworms. I'm going to leave this slide up. Many of you have asked me, are there ways where I can learn more about chronic fatigue syndrome? Or, my doctor doesn't know a lot about chronic fatigue syndrome. The booklets that are available over here, I saw them on the back table. There are some booklets available. That's the CFS primer is available there. It's available online as well. I don't know if you're aware of it, but Dr. Bruce Campbell and I have developed a couple of websites, and we did it particularly because we can't see everybody that has chronic fatigue syndrome, but we have a self-help site here that takes you through step-by-step the kind of things that we teach in our office, and that's treatcfsfm.org. Or we have a course, it's a 6-week course that you can take that has a it has a manual that you can read, and every Sunday we give one or two chapters to read in the manual, and then you have to do a little bit of homework, and it's a 6-week course. But at the end, you really know how to take care of chronic fatigue syndrome. And if you're the kind of individual that likes to do that sort of thing, I recommend that you do that. So these are just a couple of resources that I wanted to share with you. So thank you again. Very nice to see you all, and thanks for coming out. And praise the Lord for sunny weather again.